Today we have assembled together to celebrate the 199th birthday of the last Nawab of Awadh, Wajid Ali Shah, who is still deemed as the one and only artist Nawab in India's political history. Today we are pleased and humbled to be in the company of Wajid Ali Shah's great-great-grandson, His Majesty Mirza Shahanshah Ji, who will be remembering and talking about his ancestry so close to the heart of Bengal and Calcuttians.
Hello everyone. You are welcome to the music section of the space.inc. Today we have a very special guest with us on the occasion of Nawab Wajid Ali Khan's birthday. Today we have his great-great-grandson, Shahanshah Mirza Ji, with us. Good evening, sir, to our platform. So it's a very special day for us. Yes, good evening. It's a very special day and special occasion for us. It's Wajid Ali Shah's birthday, and we are having his great-great-grandson with us. So we are very much privileged, and we are very happy, excited to have you with us. So, can we start our interactive session directly with your permission? Can we start?
Yes, please. Thank you very much for organizing this. Thank you very much for having me over.
We are truly honored. We are very, very glad and honored too. So, I wanted to know that what was the source of Wajid Ali Shah's interest in art, culture, and actually you are, as a direct descendant of his family, you would be the best person to explain what was the secret of his mizaj. His mizaj was so rare. So can you tell me what was the secret? What was the source of this kind of mood and his special interest to art and culture?
I think Wajid Ali Shah was a very romantic man. I say this because when he married for the first time, his first wife, Alam Ara, who was known as Khas Mahal because of her extraordinary beauty, was 5 years older than him.
Okay.
And in those days, you know, marrying a woman who's 5 years older than you was considered to be a very, very serious taboo. Even now, you know, in many Muslim community, you know, the woman is older than men. It has not been looked favorably. But Wajid Ali Shah went ahead and, you know, he fell in love with this woman and married. So Wajid Ali Shah was an extremely romantic man. And from a very young age, you know, he used to write poetry. So romance was there. And I think if you are romantic, then, you know, you are interested in art, you're interested in culture, you're interested in heritage. You have a different perspective towards life. You try to find beauty in each and everything. You try to find beauty when it's raining. You try to find beauty, you know, when it's very hot. You try to find beauty, you know, when cool breeze blow. So you try to find beauty in each and every aspect of life.
It was so nice, and it was so emotional answer from your end. So now I would love to know that how did he come to Kolkata? Means if you say something regarding Wajid Ali Shah's arrival in Calcutta. So what was the exact story? Why did he come to Calcutta from Lucknow?
He came to power in 1847, and I consider that, you know, he was an extremely unlucky ruler, because when he came to rule, by that time, English East India Company had made up its mind to annex Awadh. Awadh was not a very big state. It was about 34,000 square mile in area, but it was an extremely prosperous state, and it was between Bengal and Delhi. So from a strategic point of view, Awadh was very, very important for English East India Company. You know, when he came to power, he introduced a lot of military reforms, he introduced a lot of land reforms. People started treating him as a fatherly figure. Whenever he used to go out in processions, you know, two silver boxes were carried with him, and people were free to drop their complaints. And in the evening, when he used to come back, you know, these boxes were opened, the complaints were read, and, you know, it was being directed to the concerned department. All this was not liked by the English East India Company and British, and so they decided to annex Awadh. Awadh was annexed on a false charge of maladministration. I think, you know, at one level, Wajid Ali Shah was a very, very simple man. He had heard a lot about British sense of justice and fair play. He thought, in his wisdom, that if I go to Calcutta — in those days, the Governor General used to live in Calcutta — he thought that if I go to Calcutta, meet the Governor General and tell him that, you know, Awadh has been annexed on a false charge of maladministration, Awadh might be handed back to me. So that is why he came to Calcutta. I'm glad you have asked this question. You know, wherever you go on the Google, you know, you'll find that, you know, it is being said that Wajid Ali Shah was exiled to Calcutta. And over here, I would like to clarify that he was never exiled to Calcutta. In fact, he came to Calcutta on his own free will. The English East India resident in Awadh in those days was General James Outram. He was not liking the idea that Wajid Ali Shah is coming to Calcutta. And he tried at his level to discourage Wajid Ali Shah from coming to Calcutta. So Wajid Ali Shah came to Calcutta. And after he was imprisoned in Fort William for 26 months, he was given a chance to live anywhere in the country, but he chose to live in Calcutta. So whatever he did, you know, he did on his own free will. He was a man who had lost the kingdom, but he was being allowed to move, and he chose Calcutta because he had started liking that.
Thank you so very much, sir, for sharing the reason of Wajid Ali Shah's arrival in Calcutta. So now it's very clear to all of us why and how did he come to Calcutta. So all of us know that the great director, Satyajit Ray, he made a film on Wajid Ali Shah. The name of the film was Shatranj Ki Khiladi. So we are very much fond of that film. So as a direct descendant of his family, as a family member, did you meet Satyajit Roy in person, or do you have any personal experience which you want to share with us?
Satyajit Ray had directed the Shatranj Ke Khiladi in 1976. Of course, I was very young at that time, but my father had met Satyajit Ray a number of times. In fact, Satyajit Ray I consulted my father on many occasions, and, you know, he used to take some tips on how to direct the film. So there are two or three very interesting anecdotes connected with Shatranj Ke Khiladi, which I had heard from my father. Satyajit Ray felt that there's a lot of similarity in look between Amjad Khan and Wajid Ali Shah, and that is why Amjad Khan was chosen for this role. But before the film was being shot, Amjad Khan had met with a serious accident, and his chest was crushed. So he was in hospital for many months. And then Sanjeev Kumar had a terrible heart attack, so he was also hospitalized. So at one point of time, Satyajit Ray had thought of, you know, abandoning this program, this film. But as luck would have it, you know, both recovered, and he went ahead with this film. Satyajit Ray had gone to Lucknow, he had gone to Kanpur, he had gone to Jaipur for this film. And the film was shot in Calcutta in the Puri studio. Part of it was shot in Jaipur and part of it was shot in Lucknow. I remember my father once asked Mr. Ray that, you know, how difficult it was to direct Amjad Khan. Because before this film was released, Amjad Khan has acted in a film called Shole, in which he had played the role of a dreaded decoy. And that was totally, you know, a different type of role. Mr. Ray was a genius, you know, when it comes to filmmaking. And Mr. Ray did a lot of research before making this film. And he had read somewhere that, you know, when a king is angry, when he's very disturbed, he doesn't blink his eyes. And there's a scene in the film when Ali Naqi Khan, who was the prime minister to Wajid Ali Shah, he comes and informs Wajid Ali Shah that Awadh is going to be annexed in the next 3 days. And the camera focuses on Wajid Ali Shah. And naturally, Wajid Ali Shah is very upset, very angry, and, you know, he's pacing up and down. And Satyajit Ray was telling Amjad Khan that, you know, you have to imagine that you are Wajid Ali Shah, you are very angry, you are very upset, you are very disturbed. Don't blink your eyes, don't blink your eyes. And Amjad Khan, you know, was constantly blinking his eyes. So Mr. Ray told my father that, you know, that was one particular scene, you know, which we had a lot of difficulty in shooting because Amjad Khan was time and again, you know, he was blinking his eyes. The other thing is that, you know, Satyajit Ray didn't know Urdu. And my father told him that, you know, if you're making a film on Wajid Ali Shah, which will be in Urdu, it is very important for you to learn Urdu. And Satyajit Ray started learning Urdu. And when he started making this film, you know, he had a working knowledge of Urdu because most of the dialogues are in Urdu. And if you don't know the language, then, you know, you will not get the right essence of that dialogue. It was a beautiful film. And I remember I had gone to see the premiere show and it was a very, very nice feeling.
Great. Actually, we are getting truly enriched by your information, by your explanation. We are so glad. So I'm coming to the next point. That's a very popular point. We know, all of us know, that Wajid Ali Shah was a great connoisseur of food, of Mughlai food. So when he came to Calcutta, he introduced the aloo biryani. So we want to know this. We want to listen, hear the story from you, from the direct descendant of his family. So if you please explain the story. And one more thing I would like to know from you, sir, that I heard that the giloti kebab was introduced by Wajid Ali Shah ji. So what was the story behind it? If you can explain the story, I would love to know that story on behalf of everybody.
I'll start with Galawati Kebab. The fourth ruler of Awadh, Nawab Asif Ud-Daulah, was a man who, like other rulers of Awadh, was interested in food. And he was particularly fond of eating meat. But towards the end of his life, you know, he had some dental problem. His teeth had become very weak. But since I have got this dental problem, so I want that you all should prepare some meat dish in which the meat is very soft. I don't have to chew much. So his chefs were given a free hand and they tried various experiments, various permutation and combination. And they came up with this galawati kebab. Galawati, you know, as you know, in Urdu means melt, galawa. So, you know, when you eat galawati kebab, it's something very soft and it doesn't require much chewing. So that is how, you know, galawati kebab was introduced for Asif Ud-Daulah. Asif Ud-Daulah started having galawati kebab and he didn't have any problem in chewing. And at the same time, you know, he enjoyed meat. So it became an important part of our cuisine. And it came to Calcutta with Wajid Ali Shah. Now, your first question about, you know, the aloo and biryani. You know, Wajid Ali Shah, like other rulers of Awadh, they were great connoisseurs of food. So when Wajid Ali Shah came to Calcutta, you know, he not only came with his chef, but he also came with his hakim and a lot of other people. The first time when Wajid Ali Shah came to Calcutta, he had about 500 people in his entourage. And later on, when people came to know that he's going to live in Calcutta for the rest of his life, thousands of people started coming from Awadh. The chefs of Awadh were being told to prepare food in consultation with hakims. Hakims were, you know, the royal physicians. And they used to advise the chefs what to cook and how to cook. Because in Awadhi cuisine or Mughlai cuisine, the general perception is that, you know, it's very rich, it's very heavy. But that is a misconception. An authentic Awadhi or Mughlai food is something which is very light on your stomach. Even if you eat to your fullest satisfaction, the next day you should have no problem. You should not feel heavy in your stomach or chest. Because the ingredients that are given, the spices that are given, it is not only given in a particular proportion, but it is also given in a particular sequence. So if the spices are given, say spices A, B, C, D are given, so the sequence has to be followed, A, B, C, D. If you change the sequence, then everything goes haywire. So when the chefs came to Calcutta, they realized that the weather of Calcutta is very different from that of Lucknow. Lucknow gets very hot during summer and it's very cold during winter. And there's very little humidity in Lucknow. But in Calcutta, we don't have very hot weather, we don't have very cold weather, except for very few days. And in Calcutta, the humidity is very high. So the Hakims advised the chef that in Calcutta, when you prepare the food, you must have less use of saffron, mace, and ghee. And that is why you find the Awadhi cuisine that is cooked in Calcutta is slightly lighter than what you get in Lucknow. Now, coming to your question, the aloo and biryani. History, unfortunately, the history of Awadh was written by British, because British had annexed our kingdom. And the history is written by the victor, and it has been written from the victor's point of view. The British were very shrewd administrators, and they tried to defame Vaid Ali Shah at each and every level. The truth is that in early 17th century, potatoes were introduced in our country. The first cultivation took place in Surat, and over the next several decades, it spread to different parts of the country. It was brought to Bengal by the English traders. In those days, the cultivation of potato was very low, and that is why it was very expensive. And because the cultivation was low, it was expensive, it was considered to be an exotic piece of vegetable. Vaid Ali Shah had given a free hand to his chefs to try and experiment new dishes, to make the food more delicious. In one of the experiments, one chef took the liberty of adding this potato in biryani. Now, when biryani is cooked, the Awadhi biryani, it has been cooked in the dampuk style. The pot is sealed with the lid so that the steam doesn't go out. As a result, when the food is cooked, all the aromas, fragrances of saffron, spices, meat, rice gets absorbed in the potato. And it made the potato extremely delicious. When it was served to Vaid Ali Shah, he found it very, very tasty. So he called his chef and said that henceforth, whenever you cook biryani, make sure you add potato. And this was being emulated by his nobles. Nobles told their family members that, whenever you cook biryani, make sure you add potato. And then this was being, followed by the nobles' family friends and, friends and relatives. And slowly and steadily, it spread and it became an integral part of Calcutta's cuisine. One of the stupid general perceptions is that, Vaid Ali Shah had fallen on bad days, and that is why, he told his chefs to add potatoes. But this is not true. And I'll tell you why it is not true. Vaid Ali Shah used to get a pension of 12 lakh rupees every year. He was the highest paid pensioner in India. No other ruler got 1 lakh rupee every month. And he used to get 1 lakh rupee every month. It was a lot of money in those days. Out of this, he spent 25% on the upkeep of animal and zoo, maintenance of zoo. In 1864, he had set up the world's first open-air zoo. And he used to spend 25% of his income on the maintenance of zoo and upkeep of animals. So a man who can spend so much money on animal can certainly afford meat in his meal. So this is, just one of those things, which were being circulated by the British to defame Vaid Ali Shah. And unfortunately, a lot of people tend to believe it, but that is not true. So, over here, I would like to point out one more thing that, there's this constant debate, which is the better biryani, the Calcutta biryani with aloo or the Lucknow biryani without aloo, because both in its own way are, authentic Awadhi biryani. One was being introduced by Asif Abdullah, the other one was by Vaid Ali Shah, both our rulers. So it's like, which is the better university, Oxford University or Cambridge University? If you ask me, I would say that, my favorite is Calcutta biryani. My wife is from Lucknow. We have been married for last 25 years, and she still prefers Lucknow biryani. So the biryani that is cooked in our house, it has aloo. So when I have with aloo, and she takes out the aloo and she just have rice and meat. So that is peace.
So nice, great. And we are so lucky that this aloo biryani is the signature of Calcutta food right now. So his innovation gave us a very big gift. So anyways, we know that Vasud Ali Shah was a great poet, and he was a composer, a musician, a dancer, and he had lots of contribution to theater also. So I just wanted to know, I would love to know, did he introduce Urdu language in Bengal? So how did he introduce Urdu language here?
In Calcutta, before Vaidali Shah came, Urdu was spoken. The first college in Calcutta was set up by the name of Calcutta Madrasa. Then came Asiatic Society. Then, Fort William College, and all these colleges were being set up by the British to train Indians in Urdu and other regional languages. But the real thrust came when Vaidali Shah came and started living in Calcutta. As I said earlier, that when he came with about 500 people, and in 1859, after he was released from Fort William, when he decided to live in Calcutta, thousands of people came from Awadh. And when these people came from Awadh, they spoke chaste Urdu, and they all started living in Mathia Bhuj. And within a very short span of time, Mathia Bhuj spread developed as the mini Lucknow. People had the same spoke the same language. They had the same culture, they had the same mannerism. And since Vaidali Ali Shah was a poet, he was a writer, he had written more than 40 books. He encouraged these people. And some of the best poets, then people who used to write nohas, these are lyrics which are written to describe the tragedy of Karbala. They all started coming and they all started assembling in Mathia Bhuj. And over a short period of time, the Urdu language spread in Mathia Bhuj and slowly spread to other parts of the city. Even now, if you go to Mathia Bhuj and if you meet some traditional families, you'll find that, the language that they speak is far more superior than what is spoken in the other parts of the city. They will use some of the phrases, which are generally not heard. Like, for bathroom, they will never say bathroom. They will call it hamam. Hamam is a Turkish word. Like if suppose someone wants to offer a cup of tea, so they'll not call it saucer or half plate or a quarter plate. They'll call it tashtari. So these are some of the words which are still in use in Mathia Bhuj. And because of Vaidali Shah, the Urdu language got a boost. Calcutta was one of those early cities in India where Urdu newspapers were being published. A lot of people read Urdu newspapers, and Urdu became an integral part of the city culture. There used to be mushairas, there used to be ghazal, there used to be qawwali, and during Muharram, a lot of religious sermons used to take place, and these religious sermons were in Urdu. And ghazal, qawwali, mushaira, the standard of Urdu was very, very high. And I have heard it from my father, and my father heard it from his grandfather, that there was a time in Mathia Bhuj where everyone was almost a poet. They used to talk in poetic language, they used to talk in metaphors, they used to talk in similes, and they had a poetic expression in their language. And the credit goes to, of course, Nawab Vahidali Shah, who introduced Urdu in this great city of ours.
Great. So that's how Bengal got enriched by Urdu language with his contribution. So I would to know, as a patron of art, how he got involved into music, dance, and theater. We will come to the point one by one. That would be better for us. So I would go to music first. We know that he was a great composer, and he was very much fond of the semi-classical form of music like Thumri and Ghazal. And that time, when he was a Nawab, that time Indian music was ruled by pure classical music. But he introduced or popularized semi-classical or light classical form of music more in India. So, and he composed, he wrote so many great, very popular Thumri is like Babul Mora Naiha Chut Jai, etc. So can you say something regarding this? Who was his music guru and how did he got so very involved in this Indian semi-classical form of music? So all this, if you can focus on all these points.
You know, I think all these, you know, are the inborn talent. Music, poetry is something, you know, which you don't learn. You know, I think you develop, and the development is something very, very spontaneous, very, very gradual. And it happens over a period of time. And the best part is that, you know, you don't even realize that, you know, you have started liking it. Vaidali Shah had once said that, you know, only music can bring tears in the eyes of man. And he was a great patron of music. The thumris that were composed, it was being composed in Brij Bhasha. And that was the dialect of Agra and Mathura region. And he was greatly associated with the devotion of Lord Krishna. And, you know, I'm happy that, you know, you raised this question. You know, it is something very interesting to note over here that he, being a Muslim ruler, he took a lot of interest in Kathak. And as Kathak, we all know, you know, was a temple dance, it developed in North India. And he, being a Muslim ruler, you know, he patronized Kathak. In fact, in 1843, he had directed a play which was called Radha Kanhaiya Ka Kissa. Radha Kanhaiya Ka Kissa in 1843. So that goes to show that, you know, how secular he was. And the very fact that, you know, no one objected, once again, goes to show that how advanced the society was in those days. Maybe today this may not happen. There will be a lot of backlash that, you know, a Muslim ruler is taking so much interest in Lord Krishna. He's taking so much interest in a dance form like Kathak. He's taking interest in Thumri. And all this goes to show that, you know, he was a man of class. He was he had very refined taste. And he rose above all these petty things. Because as I was mentioning, having always mentioned that, you know, things like language, music, arts, sports, you know, it can break any barrier. There's just no geography or there's no community. There are no thick walls for this. You know, it is universal, and in you, anything which brings joy to you, anything which brings peace, anything which makes you feel happy, I think that should be welcome. And that is what Vaidali Shah practiced.
So nice. Actually, he was an artist in the true sense, I think, with such a secular mind. And if we come to the dance part, as far as I know, he innovated a new form of dance, which was called Rasila or Rasila, whatever. So, and he used to dance this form of dance inside the Raj Mahal, inside the with all the dancers and all. So can you share the story?
You know, he thought that through these medium, you can convey a lot of things. And through dance, you know, you can convey a whole story. And it's very, very captivating, very, very entertaining. And there's a huge mass audience. So you can convey your message very easily. Vaidali Shah was so much associated with it that, you know, when he came to Calcutta, he constructed a parikhana. Parikhana, you know, in English, it would be a house of fairies. And over there, you know, he used to train young girls in this art. In Calcutta, you know, he had 23 major jalsas. And there were, you know, the paid artists who would participate in these jalsas. And I have, you know, figure of 1 year in which, you know, these artists were paid 12,859 rupees. So the figure is, you know, very odd, 12,859 rupees. But, you know, in those days, it must have been a lot of money. So, you know, so these artists were being paid. And once again, over here, you know, it shows the strong secular spirit that he had. And I think I should mention it over here that, you know, the Awadh rulers were very secular. Right from Sadat Khan, Burhanul Mulk, who came from Persia. And because of them, the secular fabric in Awadh and particularly Lucknow was very, very strong. Till date, it may come as a surprise to many of my young friends that, you know, till date, there has not been a single case of Hindu-Muslim communal clash in Lucknow. There was a small problem in 1924, but, you know, that was being done by the British, but that was being discouraged, that was being controlled by the ordinary people of Lucknow. In 1947, you know, when we got our independence, it was being followed by a bloody partition, and, you know, there were thousands of cases of, you know, the rioting and killing and arson all over the country. Lucknow was untouched. In 1964, the holy relic of Prophet Muhammad was missing from Hazratbal in Lucknow, in Srinagar. And as a result of that, you know, there were a lot of killings. Unfortunately, Calcutta had no connection with the Srinagar, but Calcutta was one of the worst affected cities. But nothing happened in Lucknow. In 1992, when Babri Masjid was brought down in Ayodhya, Ayodhya is not very far from Lucknow. There were clashes all over the country, but nothing happened in Lucknow. And by God's grace and, you know, and blessings of friends like you, till date, you know, Lucknow has been free from the communal violence of Hindu and Muslim. There have been Shia Sunni problems in Lucknow, but not Hindu Muslim problem. And this is a beautiful example of Ganga Jamuni Tehzeeb, where, you know, two communities have decided that, you know, we will live together as good neighbors. And all this, you know, is because of the strong secular fabric that would be laid by the Awadh rulers and the people after that.
I think today also India needs a artistic king like Wazid Ali Shah. He is very much needed, required in today's time. So, we know that Wazid Ali Shah was a playwright and he wrote lots of theaters, lots of plays, and he was an actor also. And I have heard that he started a theater festival in Lucknow, which was called Jogia Jalsa. So can you focus on that point? What was that theater festival and what was the signature of that festival? Is the festival is held till date, or do you share the story?
When Wazid Ali Shah was very young, due to some strange reasons, his parents took him to an astrologer. And the astrologers told his parents that, you know, he will not live for long. So they said, okay, what is the antidote? And they said, the astrologer said that, you know, the antidote is that, you know, he has to be dressed like a yogi in the month in which he was born. So every year during the month of July, he used to be dressed as a yogi. That is how this festival developed. You know, in Awadh, everything was done with a style. And, you know, people were very passionate about celebrating things. And since, you know, Awadh was very close to places like Mathura, where, you know, Lord Krishna has been held in very, very high esteem. Hundreds and thousands of people go there to worship Radha and Krishna. So this was, you know, an extension. And some of the nobles, you know, who held very high position in Awadh, they were Hindus. And Wazid Ali Shah, since he was a secular ruler, so, you know, so he came up with this idea of celebrating this festival. He extended it and he said that, you know, let's celebrate it. And people used to recollect the history of Lord Krishna and Radha and, you know, other mythological gods, and, you know, how they became very popular and how it became a very important subject in North India. And everyone participated in it, everyone enjoyed it, and people every year used to look forward to it. And I hope, you know, that fervor is still there in our country, that, you know, people should have the ability, the courage, the heart to enjoy each other's festival.
So Wazid Ali Shah used to write all the plays with the name of Akhtaripia. So is there any story behind this name? Or just like that, he chose this name?
I think maybe it just struck him that, you know, he should have a pen name, and like many authors, many writers, you know, he chose this name. There's no historical evidence why he chose this, but I'll tell you something very interesting with this. You know, in Fort William, he was kept under Nazarbandh for 26 months. And when he came to Calcutta in 1856, he came with Khas Mahal, who was his first wife. And she was known for her exceptional beauty. And she was also one of the richest women in Avadh. And Khas Mahal used to live in Mathia Bruj, and Vaidali Shah was living in Amherst House in Fort William. Initially, you know, he was very upset. He was very depressed because Avadh was annexed. And then the news came that, you know, his mother passed away in Paris. Then before he could recover, then the news came that his younger brother passed away in Paris. So he was very, very disturbed. But he was a brave man, and he didn't allow the depression to get better of him. So he did what any writer would do. He started writing. And he wrote a beautiful poem in Persian, which is called Husn-e-Akhtar, which in English means Sorrows of Akhtar. It's a very long poem. And that's what been stolen by the British, and it has been kept in Windsor Castle. You know, it is our property, it should be with us, but you know, it is what has been stolen by the British. Anyway, that's a different story. But the important thing is that, you know, when he was living in Fort William, the British were very scared that if anything goes wrong with Wajid Ali Shah, there'll be strong rebellion in Lucknow and in Calcutta. So they wanted to keep him in very good humor. So every day his food used to come from Mathia Bruj, his own kitchen in Mathia Bruj. And his wife used to send the food for him, along with paan, and along with 5 strands of hair. The wife used to cut 5 strands of hair every day, and she used to pack it in a piece of paper. Then she used to pack the food, the paan, and whatever other food items were there, and it was being sent through a carrier. So Wajid Ali Shah used to look at those strands of hair every day. And I think it must be a great romantic feeling, you know, seeing the hair. You can't see your wife, but, you know, at least you can see the hair of your wife. And I'm sure it must have evoked a lot of passion and, you know, interest in him. It is almost like, you know, meeting her. So that was the level of his romanticism. And all this has been expressed in his book, in his poetry, in his literary work, which is, you know, very, very romantic. And, you know, you have to understand this from his perspective, then you'll be able to actually enjoy it.
Wajid Ali Shah was a very versatile person, and he was very much fond of sports also. That's what we heard. So, and he introduced this kite flying in Bengal. So can you say something about it? How did he introduce this sport in Bengal, and is there any story?
When Wajid Ali Shah came to Calcutta, he introduced many things. One was kite flying, the other one was pigeon flying, one was cock fighting. Then there was another competition in Urdu where you say a certain line in Urdu and the other person has to counter that, and for all extempo. So, you know, it was a great literary experience for everyone. You have to be really very educated, very talented. You must have a very good sense of humor. You must be quick-witted to, you know, to reply immediately. Regarding this kite flying was a very, very popular sport in Avadh. So when Wajid Ali Shah came to Calcutta, he introduced kite flying. And soon it caught the imagination of the zamindars and the Bengali babus in Calcutta. And it became a very, very important sport. Every young man in Mathia Bruj used to fly kite. And it was serious business. Competitions were being held, and the winner would get a lot of prize money. A person who would cut 9 kites was considered to be a champion. And that kite was being brought down, and it was being framed, and it was being kept as a piece of ornament. People used to say that, you know, this particular kite was flown by Mr. So-and-so, and it has cut 9 kites. So, you know, it's like a cricket bat which is being used by a batsman for scoring, you know, 10,000 runs. It was almost like that. The interesting thing about kite flying is that in Mathia Bruj, it developed into a cottage industry. And over the years, the interest in kite flying has gone down because, you know, now we have got so many other attractions or disattractions in life. But even today, kite flying is a very important cottage industry in Mathia Bruj. There are about 3,000 people who are engaged in kite flying, in kite making. And the kites that are made in Mathia Bruj are supplied all over the country. The biggest kite festival is held in Gujarat on the day of Makar Sankranti in January. And the kites that are flown in Gujarat, most of these kites are sourced from Calcutta, from our own Mathia Bruj. The very interesting thing about this kite making in Mathia Bruj, most of the workers working in this kite making industry are women. There are many women in Mathia Bruj who are not very well educated. They don't have a formal education or a formal training or any other vocational training, but they are trained how to make kites. So they don't have to go out, you know, they make kites in their house. And every week, you know, some Mahajan comes, collect the kites, count number of kites and give them X, Y, Z amount of money. It is not extraordinary big money, but at the same time, you know, it is some money, you know, which takes care of their family needs. And to me, I think, you know, it is a great economic activity for the women and for the men of that area to be engaged in an activity like this. I think the credit goes to Wahid Ali Shah because, you know, he introduced kite flying. And because of him, you know, a lot of people are getting a regular source of income.
Bengalis consider Wahid Ali Shah as their own Nawab. And Bengalis are very, very much fond of their own Nawab. So would you like to say something about Wahid Ali Shah's love for Bengal?
I strongly feel that Wahid Ali Shah is far more popular in Calcutta than what he is in Lucknow. He spent last 31 years of his life in Calcutta. When Wahid Ali Shah was released from Fort William, he was being given an opportunity to live anywhere in the country. But you know, his brief stay in Calcutta in Bengal made him realize that, you know, if there's any place in India where he'll get a lot of love, respect, affection, it is Bengal. And I'm very happy that even after 134 years after he died, the people of Bengal love him. You know, I work for government and, you know, I had the opportunity of traveling all over the state. And I have seen that the common man in Bengal has a lot of love and respect for Wahid Ali Shah. And I don't know where Wahid Ali Shah is now, but I'm sure that, you know, from wherever he must be hearing this conversation of ours, he must be smiling that the decision that he took in 1859 to settle down in Calcutta has come out to be true, because even now people like to talk about Wahid Ali Shah. They like to hear stories about Wahid Ali Shah. They like to hear about his achievement. They like to hear about his contribution. And I would like to thank all of you from the core of my heart and on the behalf of our entire family that, you know, you all give him so much respect. It is a good fortune that, you know, Wahid Ali Shah is getting so much love and respect even in 2021. Thank you very much.
We are actually very much thankful to you, sir, as you are spending your valuable time with us. So that's why we are truly fortunate. We are feeling truly fortunate. So I would like to know how British government or the East India Company, they could not ignore the sociocultural or the sociocultural political legacy of Wahid Ali Shah.
You know, when Wahid Ali Shah died in 1887, there were about 10,000 people in his funeral. People from all communities, from different walks of life. They were crying, they were weeping, they were pulling their head, they were beating their chest. And all this made the British very nervous. They realized that, you know, even after his death, Wahid Ali Shah is an extremely popular man. And they tried to do everything to wipe out his memory. You know, and they started with the famous idiom that, you know, out of sight, out of mind. So what they did, you know, they started demolishing all his palaces. He had built about 20 palaces in Mathia Bruj, and they demolished each and every palace. Some were being demolished because they said that, you know, we are going to expand Calcutta Port Trust. And some were demolished because the Garden V shipbuilders had come up. So on one pretext or the other, you know, these palaces were being destroyed. And the compensation that would be offered was the pittance. And you like our ancestors never took any compensation because they felt that it is an insult to accept such a small amount of money as compensation. They just left Sitanabad Imambara, which was built by Vajiralisha in 1864, and he was buried over there. And it is a place of worship. They left the Shahi Masjid, which was his personal masjid, and they left, you know, two small Imambara, because all these were places of worship. And as I said, you know, they were shrewd administrators, so they thought that, you know, if they do anything to these religious places of worship, there will be a very, very strong backlash which they cannot control. So they tried everything, you know, whatever they could to defame this man, to erase the memory of Vaidyalisha from the minds of people in Calcutta and India. But, you know, our session today showed that, you know, they have failed because, you know, people are still interested in Vaidyalisha and they take a lot of interest in knowing more and more about Vaidyalisha.
Okay. Now I want to share a very personal question of mine. I have seen a very popular photo of Wazid Ali Shah on Google, where he is standing in a position where his hand straight down. So as a king, how can he stand in such a posture? So I always get very much surprised. So as a family member, as a descendant of his family, can you say something on this issue?
I think you're talking about that picture where his left chest is exposed.
Yes.
You know, in Urdu, we say that, you know, mera dil khula hua hai, which roughly means that, you know, my heart is open. Vaidyali Shah was a king. He was a poet. He was a writer. He was a thinker. And at the same time, he was a very, very sensitive and emotional person. So it was sort of a symbolical gesture which he wanted to convey to the world that, you know, my heart is open. I'm ready to hear each and every complaint, each and every agony, each and every cry. I want to hear what complaint you have. I want to share your happiness. I want to share your grief. And he thought that, you know, as a king, unless and until he hear, observe, feel, experience what his subjects are undergoing, then only he'll be able to rule. Similarly, for a writer, unless and until you understand each and everything of a particular subject, you will not be able to write well. It was a symbolical gesture on his part to say that, you know, I'm ready to accept and absorb everything in my heart. Of course, you know, nothing happens in the heart, it's all in the brain. But, you know, in Urdu, we say that, you know, dil khush hua, I'm very happy. But you know, the heart doesn't get happy. It's all in the brain. The brain gets happy. That is where the nervous system is. But it was a metaphorical gesture on his part to explain to the world that, you know, you can tell me anything. I'm ready to hear. I'm ready to absorb it. I'm ready to hear it and act accordingly. And that is why, you know, you find this picture in many places. And is one of those poster picture of Vaidyali Shah.
Okay, actually, we got so very enriched by this session, and we are very, very much thankful to you as you gave us so much valuable time. Thank you so very much, sir.